Hello everyone. So after we go outside so early, something like 1 or 2 hours before sunrise, we reach the location that we are going to. We start to take our time to find a good composition. We set up our cameras and start taking photos. We hope that the best light conditions will happen. We take a photo that we like or we are proud of. After that, we go back home. This is only half the process. Now it's time for another process, which needs a lot of time and a lot of patience also, which is the post-processing of the photo. As we all know, whatever camera you have, expensive or cheap, it can't give you the exact same scene which you were looking at with your eyes, or I mean the thing that you were feeling during taking the photo. It will give you a very flat photo with less contrast or no contrast at all, which requires you a lot of work to try to achieve the photo that you were thinking about during taking the photo, or the thing that you are feeling during taking that photo. So that's why today I'm going to share with you the 5 must used editing techniques for me I use always in every landscape or woodland photo. So the first one for today is adding a graduated filter to the sky. I use this technique the most when I'm taking photos for seascape, for example, or lakes, when you know there's horizon so clear and we have the sky, and after that we have the lake and the foreground. So I will show you this photo here as an example. As you can see, I made some editing for this photo, and if I click on the graduated filter, I did add one to the sky. So what I did is that I reduced the exposure a little bit, the highlights, and added a little bit of clarity. I like always to make these 2 photos like that, where there's a lot of clouds and heavy clouds. I like to add clarity to make the clouds more interesting and more visible. So if I want to make also more clarity, let's say something like 20, 30, 40. So as you can see, this is the before and this is the after. As you can see, the sky is more interesting and more beautiful after adding the graduated filter, because I took off the highlights, so the sky is more dark, and by increasing the clarity, the clouds here are more visible and more interesting than without the graduated filter. So it's up to you to make the edit that you want. It depends on the scene in every photo, but the most important thing, which I say always, don't overdo anything. Here, for example, I can also increase the saturation a little bit. Just be sure not to overdo anything, because this is a local adjustment only to the specific space of the photo. When anyone looks to the photo, knows directly that there's over editing in this place of the photo. So that's why I try always to make on and off, just to make sure that the photo doesn't look so bad. So here is another example. This photo is made from 1, 2, 3 photos panorama. This is after merge and this is after cropping it and making some adjustment. So here is the same thing. I will add, for example, graduated filter to the sky. I can, for example, take off the highlights a little bit, and now I will not increase the clarity because there's no clouds at all. And when the sky is clear, there's no clouds, there's no information in the sky, there's no need to increase the clarity. I like to decrease the clarity in situations like this. Not too much, something like 10%, minus 10%, and maybe adding a little bit of saturation here also, because we have the blue color and the yellow color of the sunrise. So it's not a bad idea to increase the saturation a little bit, take off the clarity, take off the highlights. So this is the before, after, before, after. The second technique for today is using the radial filter to emphasize the light source. I like to use this technique a lot in sunrise or sunset photos, where there's a specific light source, which is the sun. When you want to use this technique in cloudy days, where there's no specific light source, everything is flat, it doesn't work very good. But I like to use it when the sun is visible in the photo and the light source is very visible. So I will take this photo as an example. I will take a radial filter and I will make one big here, And the center of the radial filter, I will put it exactly on the sun. So I will give a little bit of exposure, for example. I will go back with the highlights in order not to have any harsh highlights or clipping. I will go back a little bit with the clarity because this is a light source and obviously it will be soft. Maybe give a little bit also of exposure. Go back with the highlights. Just a little bit of saturation won't be bad. Now this is before, after, before, after. So it's like giving a little bit of more light to the light source to draw the eye directly to the light source of the photo. Because as we all know, the eyes go directly to the brightest area of the photo. Here is another example from the exact same morning. I will make also a radial, big radial filter here. I will take it exactly on the sun. I will give also a little bit of exposure, take off the highlights a little bit, take off the clarity, not more than 10 or 15%, adding a little bit of saturation, a little bit also of exposure again. So this is a before, after, before, after. So the third one for today is adding that 3D feeling or 3D dimension by using the brush, by using the dodging and burning. I will show you this example here. So what I try in dodging and burning actually is I give more lights to the highlights area, to the areas where the light is hitting the ground, the branches, for example. And I give also more shade to the areas where there's shadows. And by doing that, I start to make the photo look more 3D dimension. Like in painting, for example, they use the light and the shade to give any 3D feeling or 3D dimension to the subject. So I have this photo right here. As you can see, I made my adjustment here. Now I will select the brush and I will come here and select lighten. So as you can see, here is a light on the ground. I will do like that here. And here a little bit. And as you can see, these branches here, the small branches here, have a little bit of light. So I will paint over it. I will continue here. And if I zoom into this area here, in between here, there's a little bit of light. So as you can see, here is shade, light, and shade, light. So I try to lighten only the areas where there's already light. So let's take off the mask to see the effect. This is before, after. Before, after. Now I will take a new brush and I will do the opposite. I will select burn or darken. And now I will do exactly the opposite thing. I will go over every area which is in shade and I will paint over it. Let's show the mask to know where I am painting exactly. So this area here in shade, and as you can see, obviously all this area here and this corner here and this small area here also. So in lighten or in dodging, I made this area here and I said that here there's a little bit of shade and I was making a mask on this area here in lighten. And if I zoom in, as you can see, here is a little bit of shade in this area, so I will paint over it. So now I will make done. After that, I will make like that, before, after. Before. So as you can see right now, the photo is a little bit flat, and after applying the dodging and burning, you start to feel that there's 3D feeling. So the fourth technique for today is adding a little bit of softening to the photo, or which is famous of Orton effect. But again, I am always so careful with this effect. I don't like to overdo it at all because just so bad that the photo look so creamy. And I will show you this photo as an example. So as you can see, this is the raw file after making my adjustment here in Lightroom. I will open it in Photoshop and I will show you how I will add that soft feeling or Orton effect. So here is the photo in Photoshop. I will duplicate the layer. I will change the opacity of this layer to something like 20 or 25, not more than that. And I will change it to overlay. After that, I will come to filter, blur, Gaussian blur. Here again, I will not go more than 20. So as you can see, this is before, after, before, after. It's not that very big effect, but as you can see, it gives a very nice feeling, especially in foggy morning or in the photos where there's a lot of fog and the photo is already soft because of the fog. I like to add this effect a lot. So as you can see, this is the before, after. And again, if I overdo it, let's say for example 75, as you can see, the photo looks so bad right now and it's like so creamy and I don't like it at all. So I don't go more than 20 or 25, not more than that. So as you can see, this is before, after, before, after. So I don't feel, actually for me, I don't feel there's specific situations where you can't use this method or this technique. I like to use it always, but as I said, I don't like to overdo it at all. So the last technique for today is using a mask when you want to add sharpening for the photo. Let me show you an example here. As you can see, this photo, I did already add a little bit of sharpening, 41, and I made a mask something like 75. And if I hit the Alt key and I click here, you can see that the sharpening is affecting the white areas and not the black areas. And this is very important in sharpening because, let's for example take off the mask, and you can see right now, if you zoom in to any place in the photo, you can see that all the photo is sharp and it looks so crispy, and I don't like the sharpening to affect all the photo. That's why the best thing is to make a mask and to let the white areas only to be affected with the sharpening. So with this method, I am just making sure that the photo doesn't look so crispy because of the over sharpening, and at the same time I'm preventing the photo to have a lot of noise. As you know, when we increase the sharpening, we are increasing the noise at the same time. So these were the five techniques that I use always, and as I said at the beginning, the most important thing is to be careful and to be sure not to overdo anything, because anyone has a little bit of experience in post-processing or in photo editing can know directly that this photo is over edited and it will look so bad. So thank you very much for watching this video. I hope it was helpful. I hope you came across something new. Please consider subscribing if you are not already, and see you in the next video. Bye.